Thanks everyone for this joining today's Contributor Weekly. The main agenda is to go over the items that have gotten fixed in 0.6, bug fixes or enhancements, and then what are the limitations with 0.6. It's an open session, so I will just share what we have already populated as a release note here. I'll just read out each of them and see if there are any questions with regards to that, if we need to modify this release notes a bit to reflect the current status, etc. Feedback welcome here. All right, so we're almost there. I've actually, in fact, last night created the 0.6 tags for all the components. I'm doing one final round of testing with the Helm charts update. So most likely by today, the PR that's going to update all the components to 0.6 will also be merged. The new capabilities or enhancements that we have included here are primarily the capability to take snapshots via the Kubernetes. So with this release, we will have a couple of new containers spawned for taking snapshots and also creating clones from a snapshot. So for example, if you install 0.6, like I have here, I've installed it with a Helm chart right now that I'm working on. You will notice the snapshot operator as a new pod that's going to get spawned as part of the OpenABS installation. And it actually has two containers that get launched. Let's quickly check that one. So one container is the snapshot controller. This is the one that actually helps in creating the snapshots. When you say kubectl snapshot, this is the service that gets triggered, which issues a call to the MyAPI server to take the snapshot. And snapshot provisioner is the one that's actually listening for creating the cloned volumes. For the calls to go to the snapshot provisioner, we also have one new storage class added. So we'll get to see if we do. There's something called as OpenABS snapshot promoter, which goes to that snapshot promoter. It's a pretty simple one. Any questions on the first aspect on what to expect? Also, this volume snapshots capabilities were there in 0.5.4 from the MyCTL side. We just extended it to the kubectl as part of this release. And in addition to that, the clone feature has been introduced with limited functionality. So for example, you can use the clone functionality for creating a cloned volume with one replica. So noted that down as a preview support. All right, if there are no questions, then we can move on to the next one. The second one is ability to create volumes using cast templates. This actually involves probably a separate discussion to get into what exactly cast templates and or etc. This is a gated feature right now. So we'll have some documentation available on how to enable the cast templates in a separate blog or in a documentation section. This is mostly aimed for developers right now. We don't expect the users to use this feature. So several MySQL enhancements have been made. We kind of spoke about some of them in the previous Contributor Weekly. The main one being the MySQL info that allows you to get the status of the different replicas, whether they are in read-write mode or read-only mode or status unknown, that kind of stuff. Right. We also have a feature right now to provide then we can configure the MyAPS server to specify on which Kubernetes nodes the replica pods will be scheduled using a node selector. This can be done via an environment configuration. I'll just show that one. If you are launching this via the OpenEBS operator, you can uncomment these lines here, which will allow you to specify the nodes on which the replica nodes will be scheduled. Also, I've made this as a new configuration value for Helm charts. So if you are running the Helm charts under the Jiva section, you can enable the feature and you basically modify whatever is the node label that you assign for the replica pods here. Basically added, that's one new addition in the README section for this Helm charts. You can use the regular Helm way of configuring these values. Okay. So just as a catch, I think the best is to label the nodes before creating the first volume. While testing, I've seen some scenarios where if you first create the volume without actually creating the labels on the nodes, and then obviously because the label is not there on the nodes, the replica pods will be in pending state. And then if you decide to go and label the node, there is a bug in the Kubernetes scheduler that basically ignores all the anti-affinity rules and schedules all the three replicas on the same node. So I would recommend that nodes are labeled before deploying the volumes. Is this something that we should put in the limitation section or maybe in the documentation, right? Okay. So the next one is with respect to how to use cross AZ scheduling. Last week we saw like how to create cluster where nodes are spread across availability zones. To basically use this feature, I think I should have some examples here. So if you want a certain volume, the replicas of a given volume to be spread across different zones, then the PVC should have this labels specified. And if it is a stateful set, then the labels have to be specified on the stateful set spec itself. Okay. Yeah, this release has been quite long in the making. We started supporting the Helm charts back in March and April, and they are now part of the Kubernetes table. And then we have expanded our E2E test cases to simulate different kind of chaos. This is what actually took quite a bit of time for us to automate these tests, as well as identify the bugs and then start working on fixes for them. So most of the issues that are fixed are related to what have been found in the E2E. And incidentally, the users, the community members also reported some of these issues. So the type of issues that we fixed were all in the critical data path. Mostly the symptom would be the volume going into read-only or volume never getting reconnected. So here are some issues that got fixed in the GIVO.
Hi Kiran, Sudarshan here. So as part of this enhancement section and the release notes, can we include the by default OpenVS provisioner and my API server will now be running on OpenVS namespace? Earlier it was running on default namespace, right?
Sounds good. Okay, I'll add that one. That's a good one. Okay. Any questions on the issues fixed? All right, so we'll get into the limitation section. So we already spoke about the support for clone, the limitations around it. It really works right now with a single replica for the cloned volume. I also understand this is for cloning the volumes, the recommended data engine is CStore, which is coming up in the next releases. But the support for cloning in Jiva has been provided as a way to identify the workflows that needs to be defined. The workflow will not change, but it will be much more optimized with the CStore engine. Okay. Also, one of the this has always been the case, but I've kind of explicitly mentioned here, for getting a high availability, highly available OpenVS volume, we need to have at least three replicas, and volume will be in a read-write state if at least two of them are online. We have taken a conservative approach here. So we immediately get into a read-only state if we have, let's say, like only one replica with read-write, and even if the second replica is still in the write-only or a syncing state. We prefer the data to be more consistent rather than optimizing for the time.
Kiran, with respect to the limitation that you talked about, how is it like we are like more consistent rather than optimizing?
Correct. So in for example, let's say like the scenario where there are three replicas, and let's say for some reason two of the replicas have gone down and one replica is online. Ideally, data is still available and we can serve the data. But in this case, first we mark ourselves as read-only because we cannot maintain the quorum of at least having two copies of the data, right? So that's one stage, which ideally, like, you know, for a clustered kind of scenarios cannot be done. Now, let's say we have one volume that is in the read-write stage, which actually has all the data. Now, if a second replica comes online, it will ideally first come up in a write-only mode for it to sync with any lost data with the existing read-write mode, right? So ideally, till that second replica comes back into read-write, we are going to be in read-only state. Theoretically, it is possible for us to mark the volume as read-write as soon as the second replica comes back online, because by the nature of the way we mark read-only, we could potentially bring up the data from the one read-write volume and the second write-only volume, right? Write-only replica. But we wait for the second replica also to turn read-write before we expose the data.
So does it mean the controller is more intelligent in this case?
Yes, that's correct. So the controller has been enhanced to check. Okay, so that's a good question. So one of the changes that we did here, kubectl get pods, if we see kubectl get pod minus of the controller pod. One of the additional argument that we have added for the controller deployment is something called as a replication factor, right? Earlier we didn't have it, so we depend on the number of replicas registering with the controller to determine whether it's a single replica case or, you know, multi-replica case, and automatically try to determine the quorum logic that actually had some drawbacks. So with 0.6, we, when spinning up the controller, we already tell what is the replication factor depending on which the quorum decisions are made by the controller. This actually brings to another point. Maybe I should add this as a limitation, right? Earlier, whenever we wanted to increase or decrease the replicas, we would just use the kubectl scale up or scale down command on the replica deployment. While that still works, after we do that, we will have to patch the controller deployment with the right number of replicas under the replication factor. That's an additional step that we have to do with 0.6.
So here the replication factor can be it can be less than the actual number of replicas.
Yes, it can be. This is configured. Replication factor is telling the controller how many replicas to expect. For example, if there is only one replica because there was only one node where a replica could be scheduled, and if we say the replication factor is 3, then the controller will wait for at least one more replica pod to come online before marking the volume as read-write. Whereas earlier, with one replica coming up while the two other are still in the pending state, the volume would become read-write immediately. That's the optimization that I was talking about.
So what will be the default? Let's say for replicas as 3, the OpenEBS replicas as 3. Here the value will be 3 as a default.
Yes, that's correct. That's correct. So this is taken from the storage class replica value and then updated here.
Okay. So in case of, let's say the later the admin or the operator finds there are some issues with respect to the connectivity, are we saying that he can make use of this replication factor, reduce it and still let the volume work?
Yes, that's let's say that there is only one replica available, then he will have to come and change the replication factor to one. If there is only one replica available because of some disaster condition where the other replicas cannot be scheduled, and if the replication factor is 3, then the volume will continue to be in a read-only state if it is not changed to 1.
Okay. So will the controller be taking care of the state of replicas? When I mean state, like one replica maybe in a recent state than the other ones?
So the controller, each replica has some metadata that shows what is the latest data that they have based on the IOs that come in. Each IO kind of updates that metadata. So the replicas know via the controller which one has the latest data, and they mark themselves as read-write whenever they have the latest data available.
Okay, thanks, Kiran.
This actually sounds like we need to write one blog detailing the internals of how this quorum logic works, right?
Yes.
Cool. So that's about the first limitation. Okay, so this one was a tricky one. We do see this on only one of the platforms intermittently, on especially the one that we had with Vagrant boxes. When we shut down one of the nodes, we also see a momentary restart of the replica of the controller that's on a node that's already running. The volume comes back into its read-write state, or consistent state, depending on whether the replica has gone down or the controller has gone down. But we do see this scenario. This is something that we are actively debugging, and maybe like the next point release, maybe the one where we actually have a fix for this one.
Okay, during this course of testing, like or with the understanding of the limitations, do we find any case where we would like to remove out the replication logic from the deployment resource that we are using? For example, does it make sense to have different deployments for each replica?
Actually, we did some upgrade testing. I should probably put it under the note for contributors. So we, one of the assumptions for us to go from a single deployment for replications to multiple deployments was to make the upgrades seamless, right? What we noticed is as we fixed the bugs that we were finding with the data engine, now we see that the rolling upgrade with a single deployment is actually working. Right? So for the Jiva data engine, unless we find a platform where it doesn't work, I think going ahead with a single deployment still makes sense. But we should keep this under observation, Amit.
Okay.
Karthik, are you on the call? Maybe do you want to add anything on that point?
Yeah. So I think
I sort of agree with what we've just said. As we fixed some of the issues that we were seeing earlier with Jiva, I think our success rate with the rolling upgrades is better. And yeah, so I think we are still good to go with multiple replicas and single deployment. So there are tests that are going to be conducted across different platforms, but ease is better than what we had in 3.5.4. Thanks, Karthik. All right. So the next one is related to let me show this and then I can probably explain this better. So one of the expectations of the controller pod, which is again like the same thing that I'm looking here, right? Okay, so we have enabled with 0.6, we have added a couple of more tolerations, which is because the node condition tolerations have moved from alpha to beta. So the node condition, whenever a node becomes not ready or not reachable, by specifying this, we expect that the controller pod has to move immediately from the current node wherever it was running to a new node. During the testing, what I found is that this doesn't always happen. And the reason for this is kubectl get nodes. So node condition and the taints are two different concepts. So for example, like the taints that we have added are for the Kubernetes node ready state. In this case, the status is true. I've seen this particular true flag go to not ready and unknown. And whenever it goes into unknown and not ready is when we expect the controller to move. The catch is whenever this condition happens, if the taint on that particular node is updated, that's the only time that the controller will shift from the current node to the other, right? Depending on which version of Kubernetes you are running, the behavior is slightly different. For example, with 1.9.7, I've seen that when I reboot a node, the node actually gets out of etcd for a minute and then comes back. In that scenario, I see that the controller gets rescheduled immediately, but with 1.10, it doesn't get scheduled at least like for 5 minutes, which is like the default scheduling timeout. The reason is the taints are not getting updated, and the taints getting updated is actually alpha feature. So if we want that feature to be available, then we need to enable this taint nodes by condition alpha get feature, right? In GKE, I've been able to get this work by creating a cluster with the alpha features enabled. For example, if I see here, yeah, in my cluster, I've created one alpha cluster which has that feature enabled. So whenever I reboot a node right now, the taint gets applied and the controller pod actually gets evicted and scheduled on a different node. Okay. I will update this. Actually, when I wrote this, I was not aware of this taint nodes by condition was an alpha feature. I will update this one accordingly. There is some chat message. Thanks, Karthik. Okay.
Okay, so Kiran, how much time does it take for the TANE to be updated?
In case of once we have this alpha feature enabled, right, it takes less than 30 seconds to get updated. Actually, much quicker because I was doing this manually. I had to do a kubectl get nodes. The 30 seconds also is primarily for detecting that the node really went down, right? I'm testing this by going to the GKE instance and shutting down. It takes a few seconds before the node really goes down. Then the scheduler or the controller kind of looks at that and updates the taint. So it does take around 15 to 30 seconds.
Okay.
But then the moment the taint is updated, the controller, the scheduler kicks in and then it's able to reschedule it. Of course, we need to run a few more tests around this in a scaled environment because the scheduler, we need to see how the scheduler scales as the number of pods increase. The promising thing is there is a priority class features that are getting implemented in the upstream Kubernetes. So for these replica kind of pods, we will have to assign those things so that they get higher priority than the other things.
Okay. So my question was on the general limitations. Have we thought about around or have we gone through the testing for the mount taking in a lot of time?
Yes, you're right. So we did cover a case where mount takes a lot of time and the volume, if that happens, the default iSCSI behavior is to put the volume into read-only state. And then we have tested the recovery steps from that scenario. We did find some good, we had some good observations on the recovery procedures as well as part of this limitation testing.
And any chance we got to know some tricks or some workarounds to reduce the time taken to mount?
Actually, with by mount you mean how do we reduce the amount of time taken to come back to read, right?
Yes, by Kubernetes without us. I mean, if the mount time taken is lessened, it gets less, then there may not be a chance of the volume getting into a read-only state. That's where I was.
Right. So I haven't come across anything more than the node taint tolerations, but there are some ideas in which basically we are depending on back-off scheduler that actually exponentially backs off in reconnecting. Those are the things that we can influence once we go towards a CSI based node volume plugin where we'll have more control on the timeouts and all that for remounting the iSCSI volume.
Okay. Thanks.
One other thing that we did which will help in this 0.6 is earlier whenever the replicas were like down or like in unavailable state, we would return the error immediately to the iSCSI client, and that would actually result in exhausting the amount of retries that are there and marking the volume as read-only very fast. But with this, we kind of delay the response to that iSCSI command from the controller if the controller is running by saying the volume is busy So that delays the or like increases the the time before which a volume will be marked as read only by the ISCSI client.
Okay. So this in turn actually adds to the backoff, the exponential backoff, right?
That's correct. It will, yeah, correct.
Okay.
And also as a general cautionary note, nothing has changed with respect to the optimizations towards performance. This was not in the scope of the current release. Maybe. All right. That was all I had in terms of the features and limitations. So based on the discussion that we had today, I'm going to update on the namespace for the capabilities or the enhancements, and then also include the taint notes by condition alpha gated feature. Anything else that I have missed that we should be adding, or any more feedback, comments?
Okay, so this is with respect to E2E. I guess Karthik has been writing some documentations with respect to E2E. Is it that E2E is now can be developed by the contributors in general by having a look at the design doc or something?
That is the intent, but I'll let Karthik comment on that.
Yes, Amit, so we have put up a design doc where we're trying to capture as much information as possible to aid users to start T2E development and do it in an easy way. Having said that, I think there is some more documentation that needed in the current test itself, as well as the steps to actually create a new one, which we can probably push to the design doc to make it further easy. But yes, this is actually a start in that direction, and I'm looking forward for more feedback and comments.
Yeah.
Okay. Thanks, Karthik. Awesome. If there are no more questions or comments, then we can probably end the call for today. Right. Thank you, everyone.